Dervla Murphy, travel writer and transcontinental cyclist. Dervla is best known for a wealth of work describing journeys from Ireland to India and to the Horn of Africa, and from the mountains of Mourne to the Andes and the Himalayas. First of all, before we talk about your new book, Dervla, how many journeys have you actually made?
Oh dear, I suppose 5 or 6.
And how many miles have you covered in the course of those journeys?
I've never added that up.
But it's thousands and thousands. And where did you sleep on the way?
Wherever I happened to find myself at night.
But under a hedge?
Well, yes, or on a mountainside, or in a local hut, or wherever.
This latest book of yours, Race to the Finish, The Nuclear Stakes, is not your first departure into the realms of controversy. In the past, you've written books on other issues of great importance and weight, and certainly not on travel, like Northern Ireland. You've been writing for the Irish Times from Poland about the progress of solidarity there. And you've always been involved in ecological matters, you've always been a cyclist, and I can see how you get involved additionally with issues concerning pollution and nuclear power and power stations. But why nuclear weapons? How did you get into that?
Well, I didn't actually intend to get into it when I began this book, which the original idea was to write a book against nuclear power stations. And then I realized about halfway through that in fact the two could not be separated, that if you were writing about nuclear power, then you had to take the weapons issue into consideration because of the proliferation throughout the world and because of the fact that the nuclear power industry actually began, though that isn't generally recognized or hasn't been until very recently, began as a method of providing plutonium to the governments who wished to make nuclear bombs.
Through the back door?
Exactly. So at that point it became perfectly evident that I couldn't evade an issue that it would have been much more comfortable to evade.
The implication of that is that all those countries who are developing nuclear power stations are also developing the capacity for nuclear weapons, which would in a way break way beyond the common belief of the of nuclear weapons being confined to a relative handful of states.
Of course. I mean, this is the most alarming aspect of it all, I think, that it is so easy, I mean relatively easy, to produce from your nuclear power stations the raw material for nuclear bombs.
Now, let me ask you, in joining the thousands and thousands of people who've got themselves involved in banning the bomb, are you not showing the, if I can put it this way, the soft underbelly of the West and unwittingly aiding the Soviet Union? Let me throw a quote at you from the Foreign Secretary, Lord Carrington, who said just 3 days after the great London Ban the Bomb March last month, "Please be careful that your agitation does not unintentionally serve the purposes of the Soviet Union, for under their system, you would never be allowed to express your views."
No, indeed. But I think what I feel about that is, I mean, the good old cliche. I would prefer, though nobody could be more anti-communist than I am, I would prefer to be red than dead, because I like being alive very much, and I think most people do. And I can't really believe that, well, for our generation, I mean, for the people at present alive on the Earth, it could be that if we gave up our nuclear weapons, we would be dominated for a period by Russia. But I think it would be for a period. It wouldn't be forever. Whereas if nuclear weapons are used, and there is the Holocaust that people talk about so much now, well, then damage is done forever to the human race.
Well, let me put another argument to you that that Lord Carrington made in this Churchill Memorial Lecture in Luxembourg last month. He says, "Indeed, unilateral reductions on our side would remove the Soviet incentive to negotiate seriously about arms control." So by marching for peace, you are paradoxically making peace more difficult to obtain. That's the burden of his argument.
Well, I think that's a load of nonsense, frankly. You know, I mean, there have been disarmament talks going on for 20 years and more. Nothing really has been achieved. The SALT agreements have not brought the production, development, perfection, sophistication, and all the rest of it of nuclear weapons. They have not prevented that. And I think now the time has come to take the, what our critics call the simplistic line, and simply to have unilateral disarmament and see what happens then, because whatever happens then could not be worse than what will happen if we continue on the path we're on at the moment.
That's very much a moral standpoint. Lord Carrington makes the political point that
how
can you afford to indulge in the such moral luxury when you have the perceived enemy, the Russians, already with a heavy troop presence in Afghanistan, massing on the borders of Poland? Can you disarm in the face of such blatant disregard for territorial integrity?
Well, you see, I think it's just a choice between annihilation all round and possibly allowing ourselves to be dominated for a generation or two by Russia.
You think
I mean, I look perhaps very far ahead. You know, I don't think of it just in terms of the generation which is now on the earth. And, I mean, it would be horrific, and I, of all people, would loathe to have my freedom of speech repressed and to be made to work on a collective farm or whatever. I mean, nobody could be less disposed towards that sort of thing than I am. But I still prefer the idea of that, the idea of myself being obliterated, my daughter and her children perhaps being deformed, you know, I mean, being unable to have normal children. The whole genetic consequence of a massive nuclear war would be so horrific that it is the end of human life as we think of it. Whereas being forced to conform to an alien ideology is not the end of life.
As the polls have showed, which leads me neatly to your recent surveys of the Solidarity Congress, in fact, at the end of September and beginning of October. What was the general attitude in Warsaw, in Poland generally? Were they optimistic? Did they think the Russians would invade?
Well, they were extremely optimistic, and a few people I met thought they were perhaps too optimistic, that the sort of lift that the Solidarity movement has given to the whole Polish nation has perhaps lifted them slightly beyond reality to where they're quite confident that Russia will not invade. And therefore they might do something so provocative that Russia would feel she had no alternative but to invade.
Give me a little bit of the flavour of Solidarity, because I picked up in one of your Irish Times pieces a quote from a Solidarity delegate who said, "Don't treat our efforts to renew the soul and body of Poland as just a symbol of the free Western spirit struggling against a cruel Eastern tyrant." Do you think we look at, or rather does Fleet Street look at Solidarity through capitalist tinted glasses?
Well, I don't actually read newspapers a great deal. So I can't actually answer that very accurately, but certainly the polls think that the Western press is at the moment misinterpreting what the Solidarity movement is trying to do.
To return to the questions of peace, the reason I want to talk about Poland is because there is an example of a whole group of people, 10, 12 million people in Solidarity, rising up against an orthodoxy. So perhaps there's room for encouragement there. But do you think one can overcome the economic and political vested interests that there are in armaments, in missile bases, and the actual weapons industry? Do you think we can overcome those multi-billion pound industries?
Well, I think we can only do it if everybody becomes involved. Not just 250,000, though that's a tremendous figure, marching in Hyde Park or Bonn or wherever. I think every individual has to become involved before we can alter the present situation.
Does your fear of the Holocaust, as you describe it, make you a pessimist or an optimist?
Well, I don't think anything could make me a pessimist. But I do feel that we're in a pretty hairy situation, and we have to take action.
So the question mark is a reflection of your optimism.
Indeed, yes.
Dervla, thank you very much indeed for coming in. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.